materials going from the effect of external forces on a rigid body to the effect of external forces on elastic bodies in terms of their internal changes, specifically stresses and strains. So here we're no longer assuming that our engineering bodies or materials are rigid. So no longer rigid, right? We're replacing that with elastic. Deformation and dimensional changes will result, okay, in this class because our engineering materials are no longer rigid.
Now, Professor, if the dimension changes, will not that also change the static equation?
That's an excellent question. Okay, so Jason's question is this. So if we are no longer assuming rigidity of our engineering materials, and hence engineering materials, if you grab, I don't have a rubber band in right now. I usually have an elastic rubber band, but if you have a rubber band, right? And let's say that, if you have a rubber band, right? And if you stretch it, you can see the dimensional change quite readily, right? It's very, very obvious. Now, instead of an elastic rubber band, take a steel wire. If I try to pull on it, I'm not exerting enough force to see any real change, right? But let's say that we're using, let's say, an Instron machine. There is a machine specifically designed to test these things. And it's like saying the name Google, we kind of use it as a verb, right? So in this world, there is a machine called Instron, and it's used for testing different engineering materials. So let's say that I have a machine equipped with enough force to pull a steel wire, right? Even though that this, the change may be small, there will be some changes. Now, Jason's question is, if there are changes that are taking place with our engineering materials, will that affect the statics equilibrium conditions? I think that's what you're asking, right? That's an excellent question. What do you guys think? Let me see, there's a message. Oh, okay. That's about the book, right, Jonathan? I think that's what it is. Okay, very good. So there is a message from Jonathan about your textbook. Okay, so check it out if you guys want to. So what do you think? Will it affect the equilibrium conditions? Now think back to your chapter 6. There was an assumption that I talked about in chapter 6 when we were first starting to analyze trusses. And I said that the changes that do occur with the truss members are going to be very, very, very small. And therefore, what do we do in statics?
We ignore them.
We ignore them because the changes were so small that they will not really impact the equilibrium conditions. Okay, even in this class, we have to assume equilibrium conditions. If not, things are not going to work. Okay, but it doesn't mean that we're going to ignore these physical changes. There will be physical changes. And most of these changes, I was about to say that, most of these changes are going to be so small that you can't really see them as they occur. But we are going to measure these dimensional changes, however small they may be, we're going to measure them. But in the overall scheme of things, because these changes are so small relative to the actual physical dimensions of our structures, they will not affect your equilibrium conditions, if that makes sense. Okay, unless they're so great, right? And of course, if they're so great, we will not be using those engineering materials anyway in the first place. Okay, so I will say this later on, but units in this class are extremely important because the dimensional changes are going to be so small that you have to keep track of your units. Otherwise, the magnitudes change greatly and you're going to end up with wrong answers. Okay, so in statics and in dynamics, the units are pretty straightforward and they're very obvious. In this class, the units may not be that obvious. So you have to carry out your dimensional analysis. Okay, that's an excellent question. Very good. So let me go back to the notes. Oh, no, that's not the right class. Okay, very good. Let me see. So starting with the first topic, and the textbook calls this the axial stress, but this stress has many names. And another name for this is the normal stress. And I will explain to you why it's called normal and or why it's called axial. And it also has another name. This particular stress has like three different names: axial, normal, and direct stress. But they all mean the same thing in this context. And we're going to be using a lot of Greek letters. So get used to seeing Greek letters in this class. Okay. Sorry, the vibration. Okay. So this Greek letter, does anyone recognize what this Greek letter is? What do we call this Greek letter?
Is it phi or theta?
It's the sigma. Okay, and again, since we're going to be using a lot of Greek letters, you have to pay attention to what Greek letter represents. Sigma in this case will represent the axial, the normal, or the direct stress. Okay, now we're going to be discussing different types of stresses, so you have to keep track of their names and their representations, specifically the Greek letters. So if I ask for the axial stress, which is denoted by sigma, but you gave me a different Greek letter, guess what? That's wrong. I'm going to read the Greek letter as it's written. So if you give me, let's say, a different Greek letter, such as tau or theta, well, I'm not going to be able to understand it. Okay, so the language is very, very important. Just like in your statics, I try to remain consistent with your textbook. So there is no confusion between the language I use in class versus the language used in your textbook, if that makes sense. Okay, so this is our very first stress, and let's see what that is. So I'm gonna start with the easy stuff. I think I should, I was hoping for a blank space, but let me go ahead and do this. I'm gonna get a whiteboard. You guys have this in your slides, but I want to go over this with you. And let me do a little bit of review from your statics using this opportunity. Why is this pink? I don't want pink. Let me use blue. Here is an engineering material or engineering member. Let's assume that from a truss, I took a member out, right? And I'm going to draw a straight line across the center of this member. Does anyone recall from your statics what this straight line represents, which is right through the center of this rectangular member?
The line of action?
Not yet. Not yet, because I don't have any forces included, right? This straight line through the center of the member is called the longitudinal axis, or another name for this is the centroidal axis, meaning that it's a line that passes through the center, the centroid of this rectangular member. Now, although my picture does not look rectangular, it is rectangular in shape. It's a perfect rectangle. Okay. Now, Ty mentioned the line of action, right? So let's assume that this particular member is subjected to equal and opposite force, tensile. And how do I know that this is a tensile force?
look at the sense of the force, right? It's pulling away from each end of the member. So this particular rectangular member is subjected to a set of tensile forces. Now, what can you then tell me about the lines of action of these two forces and the longitudinal axis? That was a question for you guys.
They're the same, like parallel, yeah.
I wouldn't use the word parallel, but look at the two forces and the dashed longitudinal axis. I put the force over the longitudinal axis, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that means that the lines of action of these two forces, they coincide with the longitudinal axis of the member. And there is a term that I used with you guys in your statics. You may not recall it, but you should find it in your notes. Collinear. Okay. So when you have forces acting on a member such as this, and the lines of action of the forces coincide with the longitudinal axis of the member, the centroidal axis of the member, we call these forces axial forces. And you're going to see this term over and over again in your textbook. This is why these forces are called axial, because the lines of action of these forces coincide with the longitudinal axis of the member. That's why I would not use the term parallel. Okay, very good. Now, let's do this. If I'm going to pass a cutting plane through this member, now, if you're wondering, why do you want to pass a cutting plane through this member? So similar to what we have done in your statics with your truss, I'm going to pass a cutting plane. Oh, what happened there? Somewhere just through the member. Now, it doesn't matter where I pass a cutting plane. So let's suppose that I'm going to pass a cutting plane right here. That's a cutting plane. Or I can pass a cutting plane right here or right through the center. The point here is that it does not matter where I pass a cutting plane through this member to analyze for the internal behavior of this member. Why does it not matter? Remember I said to you, this is a perfect rectangle, right? Meaning that we call this member, you have this in your notes, prismatic. The term prismatic refers to when I pass a cutting plane, the cross section of this member should remain constant. So it does not matter whether I pass my cutting plane close to the left end of the member or the right end of the member or right through the center of the member. It does not matter where I cut through this member because it is a prismatic member, meaning that the cross-sectioning area remains constant or uniform. Does that make sense? So when I pass this cutting plane, and you guys can see this better in your class notes. So let me switch over to the class notes. Okay, so here you see the longitudinal axis. So the definition of the prismatic, a bar or member of constant cross section is called a prismatic bar or member, meaning that it does not matter where I pass a cutting plane. If I pass a cutting plane and look at its face, right, the cross sectioning face, it just remains the same. An axial force is a force that coincides with the longitudinal axis of the bar and acts through the centroid of cross-section. Again, I've mentioned that to you before, right? Your tensile forces or compressive forces should coincide with the longitudinal axis, and hence it's called an axial force. So let's suppose that I pass a cutting plane right through the center of this bar. Because it's a prismatic bar, it does not matter, right? And when I pass a cutting plane, just like analyzing for your truss, when you pass a cutting plane, I asked you a question. Which side of the cutting plane do you want to analyze? And that question remains valid in this class as well. Every time you pass a cutting plane, it does not matter whether you look at the left side or the right side of the cutting plane, because it should be exactly the same. So in this case, I'm passing a cutting plane, okay, or a cross-sectioning plane right through the center, and I decide to look at the left side of this cutting plane, okay? Now, what I'm trying to depict right here, this is important, okay? Does anyone recognize what these individual forces are, or what I'm referring to as the P prime in this picture?
Is it the sum of all of the tensile forces being applied? Because there is a height to this, and it's not, you know, just a single point, so that there should be forces that are acting along the vertical of it.
I'm not sure if I'll use the term vertical, perhaps perpendicular to the plane. So very good, Jason. So let's take a look at this face. And when I say the face, I'm referring to this cross-sectioning face right here. Can you guys see that? This face. This face actually has a name. It's called a transverse plane. Even though the picture right here looks like a 2D picture, but in reality, it's a three-dimensional, right? It's got a depth to it. So when you pass a cutting plane as if you're cutting it into two pieces and you look at its face, the cutting plane face, it's rectangular or it could be a square, right? It's got a shape to it. And that face is referred to as a transverse plane, okay? Now, to the left of the cutting plane, we have an external force right here. That's an external force, right? That's the force that we're applying to this member, pulling it apart. So without really knowing anything about this particular material, if an engineering body is subjected to a tensile force, what happens to it physically? It's going to elongate, it's going to stretch, right? And hence, we're going to be measuring that amount of stretch or the amount of elongation of this member. We're not quite there yet, but we will be doing that eventually. So the idea in this class is this. We have an external force applied to a member. And what did I say at the beginning of this class for mechanics of materials? We're going to analyze the effect of that external force on the internal behavior of this member in terms of the stresses and the strains that are generated as a result, right? So we're going to take this force and then see how it affects the internal particles of this member, right? Remember in your statics, I talked about the external force and the internal force, and I said, well, we're going to talk about the internal force in your mechanics of materials, not so much in statics, because we're analyzing the effect of the external forces on a body, right? Well, the time has come for us to analyze the internal behavior, okay? Now, the particles that make up this particular member gotta hold together. Otherwise, what happens? The material breaks apart, okay? And this is where the equilibrium comes in, right? Equilibrium conditions gotta be satisfied, gotta be sustained, gotta be supported so that this engineering member does not fall apart. So the particles that make up this engineering material, they're holding themselves together against this external force that is trying to pull them apart. Does that make sense? So internally, what are these particles doing to resist the external force that I'm calling P? Individual particles on this transverse plane are resisting. And how do they resist? They gotta act in the opposite to the applied force. That's why these individual forces right here that I drew. These are each particle of the, and of course the transverse plane, whatever the size is, there are so many particles, right? And I cannot draw every single particle. So I'm trying to depict the particle's resistance to this external force right here. Okay, so all these particles are resisting the pull of this external force by moving in the opposite. Okay, so why do I not have like P1, P2, P3 for all these particles resisting forces? Because in chapter 2 of your statics, what do we talk about? When you have more than one force, if you have multiple forces acting on a particle, do we analyze every single force on that particle in chapter 2 of your statics?
No, we're looking at the resultant. We want to know what all the vector addition of all of those forces are.
Excellent, Jason. Excellent. You must have had a good instructor because you're recalling information from 10 years ago, Jason. Very good. So you want to take all these individual forces and place them. These are your internal forces. These are the internal resisting forces of the individual particles. We're not going to analyze them individually, but instead, we're going to add these up and replace them with the resultant force. And in this picture, I'm calling this P prime. But in essence, your P prime is the same as your external force. Okay, so your internal resisting force, its resultant, is the same as the externally applied force P. They are exactly the same force. Why? Equilibrium. Okay, without equilibrium, this engineering material will be falling apart. To satisfy the equilibrium, your internal resisting force got to be the same as your external force. Now, let's suppose that you decide to look at the right-hand side. Will it change? In essence, it will not change, but the direction of your internal resisting forces now will be moving to the left to oppose this external force going to the right. Okay? Now, why are they called normal forces? I think I have it somewhere. I know I have it in notes, in my notes. I don't know where I put the definition. Let me just
have a question.
Go ahead. I don't know who's talking. Oh, Khaled, go ahead.
So you said that, we know this from statics, but that all these little forces going to the right are equivalent to one force, which is P prime.
Mm-hmm.
But this is not true if it's the other way around necessarily, right? Because if it's just like one force acting from the center of the prismatic object, then it's basically, if the force is large enough or if the rigidity is not as hard as it should be, I guess, then there will only be deformation or stress on the middle area of the square slice of the prismatic object, right?
No, not quite. Even though we're using these as a concentrated forces, if you think about it, force is never applied on a single particle. We just draw it like that to represent the resultant force.
Well, not a single particle, but like if maybe a group of particles, but they're all concentrated in one small area relative to the size of the object.
When it comes to a prismatic bar, okay, I know what you're trying to say. It depends on the location. So when it comes to a prismatic bar with a external force like this on the left-hand side or the right-hand side, we're going to assume, and I have it here, I just have to get to that point, uniform distribution. Because the transverse plane is flat with a uniform cross-section in plane. But if you have a force at an area where there is inconsistent area, right? Then we have to assume something else other than uniform distribution. And we'll get to that. We call that the stress concentration. We're not quite there yet.
Okay.
Okay, we will get to it. But it's an assumption that we're making because our cross-sectioning plane is uniform. And there we are assuming that the particles are all on that transverse plane. And each particle will react exactly the same. And hence, the distribution of the resisting forces will be uniform across the transverse plane. Okay, so it is an assumption. I have it right here. Internal resisting forces are uniformly distributed across a transverse plane because of the prismatic nature. And then the resultant force P prime is applied at the centroid because it is the resultant force. Again, we don't want to analyze every single force of every single particle of this cross-sectioning plane. That defeats the whole purpose. Okay.
Okay.
But we will get to, where is it? In chapter two, we get to discuss the stress concentrations over non-uniform distributions.
Right, but you said like generally we're gonna be working with like low effect forces or forces that don't have a lot of deformation on objects, right?
Sure.
Okay, because theoretically as the force approaches infinity, it will only be affecting basically the area that it's applied on, right?
Actually, even with non-uniform areas, right, the stress distributions eventually become uniform as you move farther and farther away from those particular areas. So the uniform distribution is pretty solid, even when you don't have a transverse plane as uniform like this. And if the deformations, if you think about it practically, you don't want to choose an engineering material that will be deforming greatly to begin with, right? And you're going to be selecting materials based on their yield strength and different material properties. So if you want to build a bridge, I don't think you want to choose a material, well, you want to choose a material that is flexible enough within a certain constraints, certain degrees, but you don't want to choose a material that will deform greatly because that will defeat the purpose of your design, okay? So in general, the deformations that are calculated are going to be very, very small. You can't see them really with your naked eyes unless they are well into their elastic plastic deformation that you can actually see them deform greatly. But that occurs right before the failure anyway. And some engineering materials like concrete and cast iron, they're considered to be brittle. So you're not going to even see the plastic deformation. They will just fail without real any notice. So you have to choose, and the point of this is this, you have to understand the properties, the mechanical properties, the material properties of your engineering materials, so you can choose them with discretion, right? So that you are working within the bounds, within the limitations of your engineering materials so that you can avoid catastrophic failures. Okay, but in general, the stress distribution or the force distribution in this case, the internal resisting force distribution becomes uniform regardless of the shape of your cross-sectioning plane or where the force is applied, because eventually everything becomes uniform, as you will see later on in chapter two.
Professor, what if the object, the cross-section, the area or size or shape changes over the length of it?
Sure, it will change. And that's the reality. But since, guys, don't forget, we're in chapter one, section 1.2 at the very beginning. So I can't jump into different cross-sectioning areas or different shapes because we got to get through the simple concepts first before we get there. So hang on tight because we will get there. But yes, you're going to have variations in the cross-sectioning areas, dimensions, length, forces. We're going to see all of that, including different materials, all combined into one engineering problem. We will get there eventually, but let's start with a prismatic bar. Let's get the concepts down first, and then we'll move on to more complex ideas. I promise you. Don't complain when we get there eventually, because it gets harder, okay? But we will get there. But to make, again, respond to Khalid's point, this internal stress distribution and therefore the stress distribution will become uniform as you move further and further away from those points of interest. Okay, so this uniform distribution is very solid, but we're applying this to a very simple cross-sectioning area, which is just perfect, right? And stays uniform. Let me go back here. Okay, so I have the transverse plane. I forget where it was. Let me go back to where my notes. Okay, very good. So again, to reiterate, P is an axial force as its line of action coincides with the longitudinal axis of the member. And that's what I was trying to tell you before. That's why the forces are called axial forces. And P prime is an internal resisting force, the resultant that is, because we're taking the uniform distribution of the forces and combining all of them into one. And hence the P prime is the resultant force, which is also axial, right? It is equal and opposite to the applied force P. Again, I talked about the transverse plane before. In case I forget to mention this, I'll just mention it right here. Because the force, internal resisting forces are perpendicular to the transverse plane, the stresses that are induced as a result of these internal forces is called normal stress. Remember I said to you, the axial stress, the normal stress, the direct stress, they all mean the same thing, the big sigma, okay? That's where the name normal comes from, because these forces are normal or perpendicular to the plane on which they act. That's where the name normal comes from, in case I forget to mention it later on. Okay, so we talked about the uniform distribution. That's a huge assumption that we're making, but it's a solid one because eventually, again, as the forces and their stresses move further and further away from the cross-sectioning plane, they become more and more uniformly distributed. Okay, so let's take a look at the compressive versus the tensile. Again, this is just an illustration to show you the comparison and the difference between the tensile force versus a compressive force. And we know from our general understanding of material behavior that if you are applying tensile force, the material will stretch. If you're applying the compressive force, its length is going to get shortened, right? We get that. But take a note of the difference here in terms of their internal resisting forces. So if a member is subjected to a tensile force, its internal resisting force got to be tensile as well. So there are equal and opposite forces. Likewise, if a member is subjected to a compressive force, its internal resisting force got to be compressive. Again, equal and opposite forces, right? And notice the force distribution. It's again uniform. Okay, because there is nothing to disturb the shape of our cross-sectioning plane. So we have to assume that every single force will resist equally. Okay, so here is our very first formula that I need you guys to pay attention to. I'm going to be putting the formulas in yellow highlighted boxes. So it says here the total internal resisting force. We have not talked about the stress yet, but here it is. Acting on a cross-sectional area will be converted to a unit basis, expressed in terms of force per unit area. And this is very often how it's described, force per unit area. But that's really restating the formula itself. And this is called the stress. Okay, now there are going to be different types of stresses we'll be discussing in chapter one. I believe there are three that we're going to be discussing, and this is our very first one. The normal stress, denoted by the Greek letter sigma, refers to the normal stress, the axial stress, or the direct stress, any one of those three names, is equal to P over area. But you have to be extra cautious when it comes to the area, because depending on which stress you're talking about, the formula, the definition for that area changes. And this is where students have the hardest time recalling which area to use. So if this is the normal stress, axial stress, okay? So of course the stress is the computer stress, or it could be a constraint that is given to you and you're supposed to design around it. Or it could be the actual stress that is induced in the member. Okay, so we're going to be using this formula in a variety of different ways, depending on the question, and you'll get to see that eventually. Now in this definition, P, I'm calling this the externally applied load or force. Why is it not P prime? Why is it just the P? Why are we not using the internal resisting force when all of a sudden I'm defining it as the external applied force? And the reason is because, remember I said, because of equilibrium, your P is exactly the same as your P prime, your internal resisting force, due to equilibrium. So it doesn't matter which force you use, internal force or external force, they are exactly the same, okay? And this is important here for the area, cross-sectional area over which the stress develops. Now for the normal stress, that's referring to the transverse plane, the area of the transverse plane. Now, if we're talking about some other stress, this is where the definition will change, okay? Now, before I let you guys go, because I got 2 minutes, unit. Remember I said units are very important in this class, and I expect to see you guys including units for every single line of your work. If I don't see units, I'm gonna get very frustrated and angry. So please make sure to include your units. And because I am begging you guys to include units, I'm going to show you that I'm going to include units, okay? I'm gonna set a good example to you guys, and I will not be neglecting the units. So how do you measure the stress? It's force over area. Force is measured in terms of pounds, kibbs, right? Or newtons or kilonewtons, depending on the system of units, divided by area, inch square, meter square, millimeter square, the area is squared. So let's say that you got pound over inch square. Then what do you get? We call this PSI, pounds per squared inch. But what if you have, let me squeeze in this, kip divided by inch square. What do we call this? KSI. So PSI and KSI will be used for, oh, I have it here. I don't know why I rewrote it, but anyway. So we'll use PSI and the KSI in the US customary units. Students don't really have problem with these two. It's the other two that students often have problems with, and it's in the SI. We're going to use Pascal, which is equivalent to Newton over meter square, or mega Pascal, Newton over millimeter square. And of the two, I tend to use this one more, the mega Pascal, Newton over millimeter square. And the reason is because our dimensions or dimensional changes are so small, they're typically measured in millimeters and not in meters. And you do not see this yet, but you will see it in problems in the future. We also use GPA, not your grade point average, it's a gigapascal. Okay, so we'll see that, and I will talk to you more about the unit conversion then. I know I'm out of time. I told you we have a lot to cover in this class, and there is just so much to cover in this course. But I'm trying not to rush you guys and try to cover all the bases and the details as well as I can, because everything we learn in chapter one, oh my God, my hair, right? Frustrated. Will carry over to the remaining chapters in this book, okay? So I'm gonna have to let you guys go, but I promise